Corner Broadcast. I'm Corinne McDaniel.
And I'm Nick Triplett. This past week, Phil Barbour had two clubs go to their state competition. First with TSA, who went to Cedar Lakes on March 27th and 28th.
The participants had chosen from a variety of competitions to compete in.
Winner Becca Holbrook was excited about receiving honors.
This is my first year at TSA this year, and I'm a sophomore. And what we did was I went into several different categories and competitions, and we came out first in manufacturing prototype, me and Drew Darty, and we're going to be going to nationals this summer in Washington, D.C., and we're really excited about it.
Last week, the Pro Star and Chinese classes took a trip to New York.
They left early the 23rd and returned late the next day. There, they visited the Statue of Liberty, Chinatown, and the Metropolitan Museum. Tiny's teacher, Miss Liz, enjoyed the trip.
Well, we learned a lot about the history of New York City. Most important thing is that I learned how to cooperate with people.
On the 28th, Philip Barbour hosted the annual All-County Concert. Featured performers were the middle school and high school bands and the Barbour County Choir.
Third and fourth graders from the county also sang a few songs for the audience, including Take Me Out to the Ball Game.
Attention juniors, Mrs. Hart would like to remind all of you that you needed updated tetanus and booster shots.
Okay, this is addressed to this year's juniors, next year's seniors. We're going to talk about the immunizations that are required for you to come back as a senior. The state made a ruling probably about 6 years ago that at coming in, seniors have to have a second meningitis vaccine and a tetanus booster if they haven't had one in the 7th, 8th grade time period. I've gone through the records and I have a list of students and what shots they require, so if anybody wants to stop by the Wellness Center, see what you need, we can go ahead and get those started. It would be nice to get those finished before the end of the school year so that you're set to go next year as a senior. Again, that is a meningitis and a tetanus. We give them here at no charge from the state vaccines. And if you have any questions, just stop by.
The Future Business Leaders of America met with the Chamber of Commerce for a luncheon on the 27th here at the high school.
Just as the TSA returned from their successful competition, FBLA then traveled to theirs in Charleston on March 31st and April 1st. Students contended with other members from around the region for a place to nationals in Tennessee.
Mr. Burby was very satisfied with their accomplishments.
It went great. We have six students that made it to the nationals. We have Joey McGuire, who took third place in healthcare administration. We have Caleb Sanders, Caleb Arbaugh, and Kelsey Pingley, took second place in game design. And we have Bryce McGee and Michaela Ferguson taking first place in digital video production.
Congratulations to both groups. Now to Lacey for entertainment.
Do you like reading? Do you frequently check out books? Miss Julie Scott, PB's librarian, has books for everyone's reading preference. Miss Scott tells us what it was like when she would visit the library in her high school. Living life as a librarian may seem easy, but there's a lot of work to be done on a daily basis.
It gets hectic right from the start. It's normally when I come in and unlock the doors and I've set them so that they open for everybody for the day. Usually I'm followed by about three or four kids who either need to use a computer to print or they finish reading a book and they're ready to turn it in and get another one. But I then get started and turn on my computer to find out what teachers are in the labs for the day. So I check the lab schedule. And if some of the teachers, if there's a teacher in first floor lab, then I try to either go unlock it for them or provide them with the key. Same thing with second floor lab. Once I've taken care of the lab people, of course, then I start my pot of coffee because I have to take care of my teachers too. So I do the coffee. Essentially, then I will check to see with the lab scheduler if there are teachers who've requested to have computer labs or to come in the library and work. I go ahead and make sure that I have confirmed all of those so that they get an email. And then once that's done, pretty much I'm at the beck and call of whoever might happen to need me for technical help with the computers or to set up a projector or something like that technology-wise that they need. Sometimes I get to teach a new skill or teach a new tool to either a teacher or to the kids. If it's a flow day, I get to work in the book room. Where I have a ton of books that need to be cataloged so that they can be put on the shelf for the kids to read them. And I don't have any help with me this year. to do that. So I get a little bit of it done. Then I'm open for lunches.
Everyone likes different book types. Miss Rachel Prost, one of PB's newest English teachers, likes historical fiction books. I know not everyone likes to read, and you may wonder why reading is important. Let's listen to what Miss Prost thinks about this particular question.
Reading is very important. For me, reading is the tool that lets you do whatever you want to do. And I just use Abraham Lincoln always as my example because he had nothing. And by being able to read, not having any formal education, that skill got him to the presidency.
Now let's take a look on a student's point of view on the library and see what they have to say.
I like the library because it's somewhere I can get away from all the drama and be free.
It's just a fun place to be. I like enjoy reading, so it's a good place to be.
Now let's see what Nick and Karen like to read.
Thanks, Lacey. I love a good book.
You know, I read an article about a zoo killing animals to make more room. Let's see what Shelby has to say about that.
Thank you, Karen and Nick. A Danish zoo that made international headlines last month when it killed a healthy giraffe is once again in the news after it killed four lions to make way for a new male. The lions were killed Monday, said Tobias Steinbeck-Bro, a spokesman for the Copenhagen Zoo. Two of those were young lions that were not old enough to survive by themselves and would have been killed by the new male if it had the chance, Bro told CNN. He said the zoo had tried to place them elsewhere, but unfortunately, there wasn't any interest. The other two are the youngsters' parents, described by the Copenhagen Zoo as a very old breeding pair. The new male lion was brought from Gibskud Zoo, also in Denmark, to form a breeding group with the Copenhagen Zoo's two 18-month-old females born on site in 2012. The decision by the Copenhagen Zoo to shoot dead its giraffe named Marius in February to prevent inbreeding sparked widespread outrage. The killing of four healthy lions has prompted further dismay. Some questioned why the lions were sent elsewhere if the Copenhagen Zoo no longer had space. The European Association of Zoos and Aquaria, a body governing 345 institutions, said that the Copenhagen Zoo had not broken its codes of conduct and that it has been consistent in its approach to animal population management and high standards of animal welfare. Does this make it okay? Well, you're entitled to your own opinion. This has been Around the World in 60 Seconds. I'm Shelby Bennett.
That's a terrible story. Those poor animals.
Well, the Colts have been the only ones killing it here. Let's go to Sarah with sports.
That's right, Nick and Corinne. The PB Spring Sports have been killing it. This season, Colts Corner has you covered from baseball to track to softball to tennis. Monday night, March 31st, the baseball and softball team traveled to RCV. The varsity baseball team lost 14-4 by a 10-run rule. The PB softball team was winning at the top of the first with a score of 3-0. RCV slowly came back in the sixth inning and they were up 4-5. In the seventh inning, the Lady Colts struck back to tie it up 5-5. In the top of the seventh, RCV ended it with a walk-off home run, making the score 5 Colts, 6 Eagles. Tuesday night, April 1st, the baseball, softball, and tennis teams all traveled to Bridgeport High School. The JV baseball team lost 23-3, and the varsity lost 19-3. The softball teams also lost with a score of 11-1. Better luck next time. The girls' tennis won 4 out of 7 matches. Sophomore Jordan Bowers and junior Abby Suter won second doubles. Viola Danigi and junior Hannah Gregg won third doubles. Junior Abby Suter won the third singles, sophomore Madison Sandridge won the fourth singles, and the boys team unfortunately did not win any out of the seven matches. The team was led by sophomore Troy Lawson and senior Ian Newsom, who both had a very tough match. Tuesday, April 1st, the track team went to Grafton. The girls 4x4 track team, which is senior Celeste Kelly, senior Marissa Long, junior Gabrielle Kyle, and sophomore Marley Deeb, got first place. Sophomore Nathan Morris placed in long jump. Wednesday, April 2nd, the girls' softball team traveled to Grafton. The last event that happened yesterday, Thursday, April 3rd, at Lincoln, where all the sports teams besides track participated in. Tuesday, April 4th, the softball team has a rematch against RCB at home. The varsity baseball team and softball teams have a doubleheader at home tomorrow, Saturday, April 5th, against Taggart's Valley, and the tennis team has a tournament at RCB. PB Spring Sport events are finally here in full swing. I'm your host, Sarah Snyder, and this has been PB Sports. Back to you, Nick and Corinne.
Great job, PB!
Jenna and Lily, what are we in for next week?
Today is the end of the third 9 weeks.
Tonight, the baseball team takes on Grafton at their field, starting at 4:30. Also at home, the girls will be facing RCB at 4:30.
Tomorrow, the fifth baseball plays at home against Tigard's Valley at 1 and again at 3:30. On the softball field, the girls will be playing at 1 against Tigard's Valley and again at 3. Also on Saturday, the tennis team will be playing at RCB versus RCB, Lewis, Liberty, and Frankfurt starting at 10.
Next Monday, the baseball team will be playing at home against Lewis starting at 7, while the softball game starts at 4:30 against Lewis, also at home. The tennis team plays against Lewis at the Barbour County Fairgrounds.
On the 8th, baseball, softball, and tennis take their teams to Fairmont Senior. Tennis matches begin at 4, baseball plays at 4:30, and softball starts at 5.
On Wednesday the 9th, baseball and softball play at Tucker. The baseball game begins at 4:30, the softball starts at 5. The tennis team plays at home against Buchanan Upshur at 4 p.m.
Baseball, tennis, and softball play at home going against East Fairmont on the 10th. Tennis starts at 4, while softball begins at 5, and baseball plays last at 7.
Next Friday on the 11th, track will be away at Lewis County for a meet. Baseball plays on our field that evening at 4:30, playing Liberty. And the softball team will head to Kaiser for a game at 6 o'clock that Friday.
Saturday the 12th, the softball team will start the weekend with a game away at Spring Mills beginning at 9 o'clock that morning and later traveling to Kaiser for a game at 11 a.m. Saturday afternoon, the baseball team will play a game away at Gilmore County at 1 o'clock p.m.
After so many games to mention, this concludes upcoming events. Until next time.
Be sure to come out and support your athletics next week.
Hey Nick, what time do you get up for school in the morning?
About 6:30, but I don't get home until 5:30 after track practice.
Let's see what PB students had to say, and PB speaks out.
Thank you, Nick and Corinne. Have you ever wondered if you woke up really early compared to everyone else? Well, in this week's of PB Speaks Out, we decided to ask them what time they wake up to get ready for school. Some people are early birds, with 47% getting up at 5:30 or earlier. Then we have 16% waking up at 6 a.m.
I wake up at 6:30 because I don't have to ride the bus to school.
After that, 21% wakes up right before the bus runs in most places at 6:30 a.m. Then we have 16% that crawls out of bed at 7 or late after. I guess most people enjoy getting up early to go to school.
I wake up at 6:30 to get a shower, brush my teeth, comb my hair, catch the bus.
I think that's all we have for this week. Let's head back to Nick and Corinne to see what's coming up next.
Before concluding this broadcast, Colts Corner would like to ask you to continue your thoughts and prayers for sophomore Juliana Finley, who was in a car accident last weekend. PB Rewind will now recap this week's events. I'm Corinne McDaniel.
And I'm Nick Triplett. Tune in next week for the latest news at your school.
Lounge of disbelief, and I don't.